Hello and welcome to Pecan Points Video Snark. I'm making my way through Born at Midnight by CC Hunter. If you haven't seen the other videos, you might want to do that before jumping into this one, or else you might be confused. Links will be posted below. Della gets between Kylie and this guy and insists that he can't be there. He says that he's fine, that nobody will know that he's there, but still, Della says that he can't be there. The smell of his breath wafted up her nose. It smelled like the grocery store when you got too close to the meat department. Raw meat. Maybe it's just me, but I've never been able to smell the raw meat at the grocery store. I don't know what kind of store that Hunter goes to. The other vampire introduces Chan, says that he's joking and that he's already eaten. Kylie notes that there are stains on his shirt that might be blood. He and Della go back and forth about some sort of family drama going on with Della. Chan seems to think that this camp is some sort of propaganda program, but Della insists that everybody there leaves the choices up to Della. Once he leaves, Della apologizes for Chan's rude behavior and says that he enjoys scaring people. Della begs Kylie not to mention this to anybody and says that she really needs to be at the camp right now. Kylie agrees with the promise that Della will protect her if Chan decides to come back, despite Della's insistence that he wouldn't. As they go towards the campfire, Kylie asks if Chan was the one who turned Della. Della says that she was born with the virus, not made, which leads to her explaining the difference between turned vampires and born vampires. She can obviously tolerate the scent, and we've seen her eating too. She does need to drink blood. She goes on to explain that the virus runs in her family, but there is only a 1 in 50 chance that it can become active, and even then, somebody could be a carrier, but it would be dormant. Chan apparently died in France and then came back. He knew right away why Della was getting sicker and sicker and explained things to her. But Della's parents don't know about their daughter's condition. Chan wants Della to go live with a vampire community in Pennsylvania, but Della is having a hard time deciding between her nature and the family that she loves. But to complicate matters further, she insists that the best course of action would be to fake her own death and let her family think that she's dead so that they aren't constantly looking for her. Because screw open communication, am I right? Della continues on and says that because of her changing biology, she would be nocturnal and fall asleep in class. And rather than to try and get to the bottom of what's likely an intense psychological issue, the school started flinging around words like drugs, because that's helpful. And this is naturally driving a wedge between Della and her parents, so she's starting to think that Chan is right. Again, screw open communication. Kylie starts to tell Della about her own messed up family situation when Lucas jumps out. He says that he's not gonna sit by if Chan shows up again, but this isn't reassuring to either girl. As Kylie sits at the campfire, she realizes that these people have cliques, and then the story screeches to a halt so that the narration can explain this to the readers. And look, I get it, not everybody has a universal experience, but I also feel like something should kind of go without saying. Kylie also explains that she and Sarah were clique floaters who bounced from one group of friends to the next, and maybe clique floaters aren't the most popular, but at least Kylie always had Sarah. As you might imagine, the cliques at camp aren't about how you dress yourself, but rather biology. Della hangs out with the other vampires, and so on. And then there's a super cringy passage about how Derek is apparently reluctant to be with the other Fae, because that's gay. And I'm sure that this is some weird homophobic thing, what with them being literal fairies, but I'm also so exhausted thinking about it, and I don't want to dive into it. She stares at Lucas, remembering that while it's okay to appreciate art, don't touch this one because it's dangerous. She randomly remembers one time when some bullies had been throwing rocks at Kylie. And, okay, seriously, rocks? What is this, medieval times? Did they also call her a witch and suggest that she should be burnt at the stake too? Anyway, Lucas caught the rock and chucked it back at the bullies like it was nothing. That said, Kylie decides that camp shouldn't be too different from high school and decides that she'll just continue to be a social floater. Later, Kylie lies in bed and mopes about everything. Holiday had caught her after the campfire started to end and asked her how she was doing. Kylie wanted to fling out question after question, but decided not to. Kylie's schedule says that she has a one-on-one counseling session with Holiday in the morning anyway, followed by what I'm going to call friend speed dating, and while Kylie isn't exactly looking forward to that, she feels like she might be able to cross off some things that she's not. Kylie then decides that she's hungry and wonders if there's food in the cabin's fridge. Oh, now they have their own fridges? What else? Is there a kitchenette too? How about a sunken bath jacuzzi tub? As Kylie slips out from her room, she remembers how Della and Miranda were still verbally going at it when Kylie went to bed. But now the cabin is quiet and both appear to be in their own rooms. Just then, Kylie hears something. Chapter 14. After really milking the suspense and fear for a moment, which I find hard to buy into if only because this book has barely gotten started and there's two more books following, Kylie finds a kitten. And rather than to question the appearance of anything mildly out of the ordinary, especially in a world where boys can transform into unicorns and her roommate says that she accidentally cursed a boy into constantly turning into a toad, Kylie takes the kitten into her room and promises that she'll take care of it. Kylie goes out to look in the fridge, but Miranda comes out, much to nobody's surprise, but Kylie, who is apparently that stupid, the cat is actually Perry. Because of the way that Kylie was holding the kitten, when Perry transformed back, he was pressed up against her breast. As you might imagine, what happens next involves a lot of yelling and Kylie promising that if Carrie shows up again, he will be neutered. After Perry leaves, Miranda and Della express first delight and awe over what Kylie said and did, but then it quickly turns into horror. Do you realize what Perry is? He's like the most powerful shapeshifter in the world right now. Everyone knows you don't piss off a shapeshifter. They have terrible tempers. But then they all have a laugh over what happened, and it is forgotten. Guy Miranda cursed into a toad shows up again. When Della asks why Miranda cursed him, Miranda says this. He's my piano teacher, and he tried to start playing something besides the piano, if you know what I mean. The book has never said how old Miranda is, but either way, pedophilia is so funny. Yes, I'm being sarcastic. Miranda goes on to explain that she sometimes gets her words mixed up. She has to know exactly what she said to undo the curse, which is why she can't. So until then, every time that pervert thinks about an underage girl, he's transformed into a toad and pops in for a visit. I don't have any words. Hunter legit sat down and said, let's throw in a long joke about pedophilia. And what's worse is that the book probably passed through the hands of a couple different people too, and nobody found any sort of issue with this? Della then says that she once had a neighbor who would touch himself in the front window of his home when school was starting and letting out. When the police got involved, it turned out that the guy was a church deacon, so they did nothing. So Della broke into the house and replaced the lotion with super glue so that the police would come into the guy's house and literally catch him at it. This conversation needs to have ended already. Why? Why does it keep somehow getting worse? Mercifully, Soldier Jude shows up then. Miranda's and Della's words fade to the background. The man takes his helmet off and blood starts to drip down his face onto the floor where they form the words, help. Della then says she smells blood, but then Miranda says that Kylie's aura suddenly turned black and she thinks that is a sign that there's a ghost. Then somebody says that Kylie has stopped breathing and Kylie passed. Chapter 15. Kylie wakes up in her bed to Holiday standing over her, but for some unholy reason Lucas is there as well. Holiday gently explains to an insanely confused Kylie that it sometimes happens when the ghosts get too close. Embarrassed as anything, Kylie insists that she's fine and gets up. The room starts to spin and Lucas has to steady her, which only just fills her with more embarrassment. Miranda and Della watch from the doorway. Kylie remembers hearing footsteps of one of her roommates running to get help and then her face on the floor, but she woke up in her own bed, which makes her wonder if Lucas carried her there. And even more aware of how the scoop neck of the tank scooped lower than most of her tops, or as Sarah would say, her girls are trying to peer out and say howdy a little more than usual. I'm not going to pretend like my own family doesn't have a similar saying of, your lungs are hanging out, but at least it's not that. Holiday kindly asks that the others leave while looking pointedly at Lucas so that she can talk with Kylie alone. Kylie then suddenly remembers Lucas doing the eyebrow thing that when they were neighbors. She wonders if he remembers her. But more importantly, Kylie wonders if Lucas told Holiday about Chan. She worries that she's about to get scolded. As Lucas leaves, Holiday says not to be afraid of Lucas and goes on to explain that she can read people's emotions. She continues on and says that Lucas was in the office when Miranda came in about Kylie, says that it's his third year at the camp and is looking to do some work for the camp soon. Holiday then redirects the conversation about the ghost. Still grasping at straws, even after what just happened, Kylie brings up how Miranda and Della mentioned that the mentally unstable and those with brain tumors can read the same way that Kylie is. But Hailey thinks that those are rare instances, although I'm willing to throw hands about this book's casual references towards the mentally ill. This leads Kylie to mentioning how her parents have always seemed so ordinary, and also seem to think that all four of her grandparents were as well. Holiday seems to think that some of those questions are something that Kylie should work on during her time at the camp. Kylie naturally asks how she would bring that up with her parents, mainly because her parents already consider her to be a little unstable, and flat out bringing up ghosts would not be good. Holiday doesn't really see it like that, however, and doesn't understand Kylie's problem with not wanting to be committed by her parents. This one sounds like a real winner. The next morning, Kylie and Miranda leave for breakfast together. Miranda explains that all of the vampires get together in the early morning to do something. Miranda isn't quite sure, but thinks that it has to do with blood. The thought of blood makes Kylie feel queasy and wonders if the constant sight of it over the summer will make her lose some weight. Miranda asks how Kylie slept, while actually meaning about everything. Kylie lies and says that she slept fine. Inwardly, she continues to puzzle over what Holiday said about asking her parents. She also still doesn't know what she is, but decides to start ruling out other possibilities, which she'd already decided that she would do because apparently Hunter forgot about that. And then because we have to hammer in the other side of the love triangle, Kylie then tells us about the dream that she had the night before, starring her and Lucas. And even though it sounded pretty PG, it made her feel, and I quote, tingly. Although this just makes her even more determined to stay away from Lucas. Miranda says that she doesn't believe Kylie, but that she'll let it slide, and then immediately changes the topic to a cute vampire guy. Kylie then brings up what Miranda calls her dyslexia. Miranda says that her family is super disappointed with that and seems to think that Miranda caused her own dyslexia. She goes on to say that she was supposed to be the next head priestess, but she needs to pass some tests. And if she doesn't do that, then the title gets passed on to some other girl instead. Miranda then mentions that Perry looks kind of embarrassed. She asks Kylie if she told Holiday about Perry's antics the night before, but Kylie says that she only will if he tries it again. As they continue past the camp office, the two guys in suits come out. Kylie wonders if they're there about closing the camp down. The men stare at Kylie and do the eyebrow twitch thing at her before they start to walk towards her. Thanks for listening to my book snark on YouTube. If you enjoy my videos, please hit that subscribe button. I post a new snark video every Monday. Don't forget to check out my other video snark of Stalking Jack the Ripper and The Plan. If you've already seen those, then you can head over to Tumblr for my main book snarks. And if all of that is somehow still not enough for you, then you can become my Patreon supporter for just $1 a month and read a bunch of bonus snarks that aren't up anywhere else. See you next week, guys. $1.